talked about last time.
What's up?
Yeah, exactly.
That was a
trick. I mean, just what did we talk about in class last time?
Nothing. Three ways of dealing with conflict.
Yeah, how do we do that?
Well, we don't want to use domination or compromise.
Oh no, why not?
Because someone will be left unhappy or partially unhappy, and you'll just revisit it again. So integration is better because then everybody's making sure they get what they want.
Outstanding. That is the thesis of Mary Parker Follett. And you've noticed almost the entire book revolves around that central thing, right? Excellent.
What else?
The basis of integration, it's produced by circular behavior. So that's what you aim to use.
Right, yeah, so there's a circular behavior, as in when I give you an order, you react in some way. It's not a one-way kind of thing. There's kind of a two-way.
Like if it's unclear, then I would ask you more questions. I'd be like, what exactly do you want? And then you would tell me.
Maybe don't ask. Maybe just do the wrong thing. Like I've got to
just say
correction. Right. Or maybe you're not doing the wrong thing. Mm. I need to ask you why you're doing it. Maybe we integrate together. Mm. For example. Okay, what else?
Integrate, well, the parties have to be honest about what
they actually want. That's right, that's huge, right? You actually, and sometimes you're not deliberately dishonest, right? Sometimes you just don't know what you want. Right, so you kind of got to dig a little bit to get in some facts, right? Very good. Awesome. Think about slaves and servants. Is that ringing a bell?
It's rights. Rights over and then rights with.
That's right. No pun intended. Yeah, rights. And what does that mean, rights over and rights with?
Rights over, it's like you're like dominating someone. You have like control over it.
So rights over is not circular reasoning. It's a one-way kind of thing. That's right.
Yeah, they don't have any choice.
Yeah, that's right. You have rights over a slave. You have rights with a servant, because they always can choose. They can choose to leave. They can choose to do a bad job cleaning or whatever. Not that, okay, what else?
People always to say too, like, don't delegate to avoid responsibility.
Yeah. Now this is an interesting concept. We'll talk a little bit about this today. Yeah, so you can shirk responsibility by delegating, right? But Mary Parker Follett has an interesting point about delegation. Is delegation ever appropriate? Anyhow?
Was she talking about something to do with like this situation? Like we do have to delegate because the circumstances are defined by the situation at hand.
So if there's a delegation coming, it's not that I delegate to you. It's that the situation dictates certain behaviors and we all have our own part.
Yeah, it's like that example you gave when you're in the army and you're saying like the man will be mad.
What's that? Yeah, what's the colonel going to say if he sees that? Versus, hey idiot, clean up the toilet. Right? Very different. Now, it's a situation that delegates in some way. But can I ever delegate something to you guys if I'm your manager? Not according to Mary Parker Follett. Because if I delegate to you, it means that I have power. I have power to give to you. So that's actually a power over kind of relationship. So my delegating to you is actually totally inappropriate. Because it implies that I have power that I'm giving to you. When in fact, I shouldn't be having any power at all. It should be the situation that has power. Does that make sense? What a wild idea, right?
Isn't that like, can't you just like government someone like that? Right? I mean, like, some governments can be like, well, the government holds all the power. Like, if we allow people to create businesses or to, I think that kind of, maybe there's theories or there are governments that believe that it's taking away from them.
That's right.
Like, but
that's what Mary Parker Follett's against, though. Government should not have power over you. Unless we start getting that whole thing of central planning, right? She talks about later in the book. You know, central planning, they can kind of plan for everybody's benefit. But it's not, I mean, she's actually anti-democracy. Right, because democracy also implies a degree of desire suppression, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. I have the majority, so I'm happy. I get everything I want, and then I dominate the minority, which may only be 1/10%, right? So democracy in many ways is inappropriate. What you need to do is find out what's in the best interest of both parties or all parties. Okay. And so therefore, to use your example, no, a government should not have power over people, they should have power with people. They have their function, just as we have our function. The time the weather gets above 75 degrees, my allergies just about suffocate me the entire day, so I apologize. So, are we good on delegation, by the way?
Yeah, it's not. She's talking about giving orders. That's different than delegation.
Yes. Let's talk a little more about that. Can you, would you clarify a little bit?
There should be integration before there's giving and receiving of orders.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. That you just hammer on such a key point. Right? We all agree on everything. And now we can divide up what works best, right? I mean,
yeah, it's not delegating, it's everybody contributing.
Yes. Did anybody ever see No Time for Sergeants, that movie? Oh my God, you're missing out on life. It's got Andy Griffith in it, before he was on the Andy Griffith Show. And it's a movie that makes fun of the Air Force. It's hilarious. And Andy Griffith, when he joined the Air Force, had a really special talent. He really knew how to clean a bathroom. Right, I mean, he was like really good at it. And so they made him the PLO, Permanent Latrine Orderly. Okay. So of course it doesn't exist. Cleaning the latrine is like punishment, right? And Andy does such a good job of cleaning all the toys. And see, he felt good about it.
Right, like, it wasn't a punishment.
Yeah, he was very happy to clean the latrine. It was wonderful. And anyhow, there's a scene that winds up, you need to check it out on YouTube. Maybe I'll show it during the break. Where this colonel comes in to inspect because like his latrine cleaning duties are legendary, and Andy decides to welcome him, so when the colonel walks in, he stomps his foot, and all the toilet seats fly up.
Oh, I think I've heard of that.
And it scares the colonel, and then as he raises his foot back up, the toilet seats slam back down, he's like, run out, maybe I'll show him during the break.
They were saluting?
Yeah, they were standing at attention to the toilet seats. And it's really funny. But yeah, the point is, yeah, once integration is occurred, then you can start giving orders based on what some people are, you know, maybe somebody's tall, he can reach a shelf, or maybe somebody's good at math, or whatever. And see, they're going to be happy to do that. Now, this is kind of important. This whole idea of, you know, power comes from a function, and so we can't confer power. This is, I guess, page 110. What's Supreme Court Fall talking about here? What does that mean exactly? Power comes from a function.
This is where we stopped last time.
Right? That's right. Yeah.
We can't repeat the question.
Yeah. So what does it mean that power comes from function as opposed to some sort of a power, right? Look at page 110.
Is it talking about how it's not power is not a pre-existing thing that can just be like handed out?
Perfect. Yeah. If you are in a position, you have some sort of a knowledge. And that's a knowledge that you can communicate, and you can explain. And this is how your expertise comes about as opposed to power. So think about this. Let me see if I can find the anecdote. You know, she gives so many anecdotes, but they're kind of like spread all over the book. You know, it's later on in the text about the gentleman at the conference. You guys know the one I'm talking about? Talks about this guy who was at a conference and he was really friendly with everybody and he was kind of chit-chatting and discussing, and his power came from his intense knowledge, and everybody sought him out because they wanted more information because he was just so friendly, knowledgeable, and helpful. And that's where his power came from. It came from his function, what he was actually doing. Right? When you go to the post office, I mean, and you want to know about stamps, they have a degree of power there because it comes from the function. They know about stamps. It's not because postal workers are particularly intimidating. Right? You guys understand that? So your function gives you some degree of knowledge, and that knowledge gives you some degree of power. And people come to you for advice or guidance or expertise, and that gives you a degree of power. Okay, you can be a manager because you know how to effectively lead people. You know how to effectively communicate. You know how to integrate. Not because you have a position on an organization chart.
Kind of like your authority figure or the dictatorship. She's opposing to them.
Oh yeah, she's totally anti-dictatorship, right? I mean, if you want to use a political example, right? I mean, who would be, I mean, we can think of Lord knows how many dictators. I mean, that's easy to come up with. Who's somebody that leads by example? Well, what, Jesus? And I'm not trying to proselytize anybody here, right? But you think about that. That was somebody who did not have power in a coercion or domination sort of way, but yet somehow had special knowledge and certain rhetoric and led people to follow him. Right? They followed him through his example. They followed him because of his knowledge. But I mean, he's not the only one either. I mean, isn't Buddha something like this too? Wasn't he some sort of an enlightened person that didn't necessarily have any real power, right? And he led through this kind of example. And so his power came from his function, not necessarily because he's a strong, intimidating kind of person. Making sense? Okay, so she talks about, of course, we've talked about integration quite a bit. So this whole idea of increasing power through a joint effort. What is this, and how does it tie to integration? So she says, for example, page 111, 112, depending on how you're counting the pages, right? So when a grower signs a cooperative contract, he's supposed to give up a certain amount of power, quote-unquote. Then she asks a question, but does he? His marketing capacity is certainly increased by his joining with others. The delusion of the independent farmer is now exposed to all. Take again the notion of sacrifice of sovereignty, that each nation must sacrifice a part of his sovereignty for the benefits which will come from a League of Nations. I'm going to talk about that in a second. This is a rationalization of the sentimentalist. Then she skips a little bit. She says, sovereignties must be joined, not sacrificed. She skips a little further onto page 112, 113, depending on how you're counting it. More power, not a division of power, should always be our aim. More power for the best possible furtherance of that activity, whatever it may be, to which we are giving our life. And she goes down to the bottom of that page. I think the aim of coordination should be building up of a functional total. Okay. I think the means of possibly creating new values, a wholly different process from the sterile one of balancing, not to rearrange existing values, but to bring into existence, is the high mission of enlightened human intercourse. A very different meaning in contemporary English. But anyhow, that's for another class, perhaps. What is she talking about here? Thanks. What is she saying here?
It's huge.
What's that?
Oh, sorry. It's so big.
What is she saying here? What's Mary Parker Fall trying to tell us? So she's saying that when you join in some sort of a cooperative effort, you're not giving up your power, but you're multiplying your power. In cooperative effort, again, if I were to draw it on the board, right, we look at power as a zero-sum game. You know, there's only this much power available, and now I have this much, which means I've taken power from somebody, right? The pie doesn't, it's just the same piece of pie. It's like when I'm at home, and mom's made pecan pie, and dad takes an extra piece of pecan pie, that means I don't get pecan pie. I have to survive with junior meals. Not a bad consolation. But anyhow, she's saying when you join power, the size of the pie actually gets bigger, and you have more power, and you haven't necessarily taken away from anybody. So when you join in a cooperative effort, you can do more, you can achieve more individually and as a group than you would otherwise. Our whole point is 1 plus 1 does not equal 2. 1 plus 1 equals 3. 3 being the total amount of power, right? Let me give something maybe more of every day, right? She talks about farmers in this example, right? I think about, you know, stories about my grandpa, right? Now my grandpa, where he lived, they were all poor subsistence farmers. So how do you think they did? Well, every farmer had a little piece of equipment or something special, okay? My grandpa had silos, okay? His neighbors had tractors. Other neighbors had labor available. Some had tools. So when it was time at the harvest, they gave up some of their power to get more power, and the tractor would go to ever all the farms and do the, you know, the sowing and the reaping, and then they all stored on grandpa's silos, and the guy that had like 10 sons, you know, all that labor was kind of loaned out, and so everybody kind of helped each other, and so everybody got to have a harvest versus nobody having anything. So the amount of power was multiplied by working together. That's what she said. Yeah.
So does that mean, so in the beginning, everyone in that example has their own comparative advantage?
They do.
But then once they join together, that advantage is gone, but they have more power.
Okay. Everybody gets more. So the whole point, if you look
at everybody's successful.
Everybody's successful, yeah. Nobody really had anything taken away from them. I mean, yeah, the tractor had to be used on everybody's farm, but he needed the silos, he needed the manpower, he needed the other tools and everything else, right? And you think about this. So if you look at it from a stakeholder model perspective, remember stakeholder looks at competition? This is all about cooperation. Looking at your stakeholders through a cooperative lens. And by the way, think of our friends in Japan with the Keiretsu arrangements, where I think I mentioned this last semester, you know, Mitsubishi's used the same spark plug manufacturer since the end of World War II. And they train their stakeholders to get better. Right? This is a lot like creating shared value, isn't it? Michael Porter, I don't know if you ever read Mary Parker Follett, but I mean, you see the same concepts being echoed. But then she takes it in a whole other step, and she takes it to the political level. She's talking about that idea of combining sovereignty. Man, didn't we just talk about that a couple sessions ago with the European Union? Right? When you think about it, Germany, Italy, France, I mean, these are not the largest countries in the world. They're not the most economically powerful, nothing like that. But you know the EU25, I believe, has the world's largest population. They certainly are the world's largest economy. When they say that we're not going to take American goods unless they clean up, you know, all the hormones of the beef, that makes quite a statement versus Liechtenstein saying we're not going to import your products anymore. Do you see the difference? I mean, I can use some pop culture references. Captain Planet, you know, those of you guys that watched that as a kid, right? You know, nobody watched that?
There's a parody on that with Don Cheadle.
Oh, it's on
YouTube, yeah.
I have to check that out.
Yeah, but I watched it.
I watched it too, but yeah, see, they put their hands in the thing, and there you go. So it's the same idea, whether you look at it from the European Union, Captain Planet, or a bunch of farmers. The advancement of business, government, society, right? So far, so good? Making sense? Okay, so, yes, I realize for next Thursday, you're going to have to look at Taylor, which is what we're trying to get a hold of this book for you. But let's give you just a little bit of tease of Taylor, right? Mary Parker Follett was very much aware of Frederick Taylor and scientific management. Actually, scientific management's a movement that started a little before the Civil War, but Taylor's the one that popularized it. What is she talking about, this scientific management in management? I guess this is page 116 or 117, depending on how you're counting the pages. Right, so she asks us a question. Okay? The word profession, connotes for most people a foundation of science and a motive of service. That is, a profession is said to rest on the basis of a proved body of knowledge. And such knowledge is supposed to be in the service of others rather than merely for one's own purposes. Let us ask ourselves two questions. How far does business management rest on scientific foundations, and what are the next steps to be taken in order that business management shall become more scientific? Well, it's the same thing Frederick Taylor's asking, basically.
So I love this. First, of course, is the development of so-called scientific management, which, after its early stages, began to concern itself with the technique of management as well as the technique of operating. Secondly, there is an increase in the tendency towards specialized, or what is being called functionalized management. Functionalized management has indeed not yet been carried far. In some cases, the only sign we see of it beyond the recognition that different types of departments require different kinds of knowledge, da 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 da. Okay? And then she goes on and says, arbitrary authority is diminishing. Surely an indication that more value is being placed on the scientific method. Do you guys understand the context why she feels the need to say this? What's she talking about? Why even bring this up? What is she talking about?
Mike? Well, I'm not exactly sure if this is what she's talking about, but I think she later says that business is always like changing.
Yeah.
So you have to use the scientific method to like test out like new methods that will work, but I'm not sure.
And you're getting there.
And management should be knowledgeable, not just
yes.
somebody that's thrown in charge for with no skills, no knowledge.
Let's build on this a little bit. Both of your comments, right? Frederick Taylor has this movement. You're gonna see. You're gonna hear all about it very shortly. Okay. And his idea is, you do not give orders to somebody because of a position in a hierarchy. And the role of a manager is not to give orders. A role of a manager is to design tasks. Okay? So what does Frederick Taylor do? He looks at how people perform basic tasks. His famous examples are hauling pig iron, that's like big pieces of wrought iron that he carries around, and shoveling coal. Shoveling coal on the railway cars, that is. And so he says, well, you know, if you want to maximize how much pig iron you haul, you have to do it this way. And so he would follow people around with a stopwatch. And he'd say, all right, pick up that coal and carry it over here and dump it in the thing. And now that you've carried three things of coal, now you take a 5-minute rest because you've worked exactly 15 minutes and you're going to sit right there and you're not going to do anything. And we're going to time that 5-minute rest. Okay, great. Now you're going to get up and you're going to carry it at exactly this angle of your arm. Okay, you're not going to carry it like this, you're not going to carry it like this, you're going to carry it exactly the way that I tell you because that's the most efficient way. And when you shovel coal, you're going to shovel it with a shovel that's exactly the same size as everybody else's, and when you do it, it's going to be this ergonomic thing. You're not going to shovel like this or, you know, like between your legs or, you know, anything like that. You're going to do it, you know, very steady, exactly the way I tell you. And when you've worked your 21 and a half minutes, you're going to take a 13-minute, 45-second break, and you're going to take it right there, you know, 5 steps away. And that's just the way a task is designed. And that's what a manager does. That sounds crazy, right? However, output dramatically increased in everything Taylor did. 3, 4, 5 times the amount. Okay? So the whole point of a manager is not to give orders. You explain to that worker, hey, do it because I've designed it this way. Now, it's an interesting idea, though. Follett, I don't know, understands Taylor the best. I mean, she seems to kind of imply a degree of coercion going on here, right? In all truth, though, Taylor actually accepts input from workers. Okay, he's not as open as Mary Parker Follett has suggested, but he does ask them, well, why do you do it this way? And they'll tell him, hey, I do it this way. And if you have a better way of doing it, you get rewarded financially.
You could learn from that.
Yeah, and Taylor absolutely learns from workers. He absolutely learns from workers. But he's still kind of he was known to be kind of a jerk, and nobody liked him. And he had to die before his ideas actually took hold, because people liked the ideas, they just didn't like him. Sadly.
Wouldn't that be micromanaging?
Oh, yeah. It's totally micromanaging.
But they thought it was okay.
Well, this is why it was okay. And this is why it wouldn't work today. When Taylor was writing, suffocation.
Are you sick? I've deleted classes.
No, it's just, just allergies. Don't worry, I'm not contagious.
Okay.
The weather's above 75 degrees, I can't breathe.
That always happens to me. Or if it changes, so if it starts raining.
Yeah. Rain, I'm good.
Take what's the allergy medication?
I'm taking something, don't worry.
Not Zyrtec. The one that makes it,
Benadryl.
Is it Benadryl? Yeah, just take that, it helps.
Makes you pass out, though.
Exactly, so take it at night.
Yeah.
Or if not, what helps, even though I don't have allergies, I take Allegra, and it opens all
Oh, yeah.
I love that stuff.
I'll take some Zyrtec tonight.
I don't know about Zerkin. I don't use that.
It works. But
let me answer your question.
Oh, yeah.
This is important, right? Is it micromanaging? Absolutely it is. But you also have to remember, workers back then were very different than workers now. I mean, we're all reasonably well educated. Those workers back then were not. Okay? Taylor had to face all sorts of things that managers don't have to face today. It was a challenge for Taylor to convince workers not to show up drunk. Okay? It was a challenge for Taylor to convince workers to show up on time. It was a challenge for Taylor to convince them to actually work while they were there. I mean, it was quite common. Taylor gives a lot of examples of this. A guy is working, he's shoveling, he's doing a great job, and you know what happens? They say, hey, don't you shovel so much. I'll beat the crap out of you if you continue working so hard. You take
it
easy.
You make everybody else look bad, right?
That's right. You take it easy when you're at
work. You're going to get paid no matter what. It's like, and in my industry, it's like never pay a painter by the hour. Pay him by the job.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Or like what I get when I was a cadet, there was a lot of helping. So Taylor calls this soldiering, and I understood because I didn't do that when I actually joined the Army. But when I was a cadet, there was a lot of helping that went on. You know, helping my friend sleep in the van. Helping my friend sit on his backpack. Helping my friend finish his food. You know, helping my friend get some water. Helping my friend figure out where his fork was. So there was a lot of helping and not a lot of, you know, really getting done. You know, or figuring out what people's names were. We did a lot of that. You know, what's your name? John. Oh, okay, you write it down. Wander off mumbling. You come back, you know, what's your name? John. Oh, is it still John? Yeah. Let me investigate then. Then you wander off mumbling. So there was a lot of this going on, right? Just to look busy. And so this is the kind of stuff that Taylor had to face. You face a little bit less of that today, though, right? You can explain things to workers. Also, a lot of workers didn't speak English at Taylor's time.
More structure now.
Exactly. And because of Taylor, I want to point this out. Because of Taylor and railways, that's why people start wearing watches. Okay, before that time was just kind of...
whatever.
You know, it just kind of whatever it was, right? So there's a lot of things today that we don't have to deal with that Taylor had to witness. I know most workers would resent you doing it that way. But at that time, that was what was necessary just to get things moving in a direction, period. Right?
Well, it seems to me that, like, there's, like, machines that actually do the jobs that they did back then. Now, instead of, like, maybe it was just so inefficient to get the workers to do things that time, just decided to move on to machinery.
And machines got designed better and everything. I mean, you have to remember Taylor, the things he's observing is like 1890s, early 1900s. The book was published in, what, 1911? So, I mean, this is kind of the early stage of the Industrial Revolution. But that was what...
I think, like, the way you mentioned that, because of the education that we have now, we actually think of ourselves. So we know how to get the job done much easier and in a much more efficient way back then, because they weren't trained to think. They were just like, I gotta get this done, so
it doesn't matter
if I'm drunk or anything, I'll just get it done.
They thought, but it was rarely good, right?
They didn't consider
the consequences.
You know, doing better in life or working hard to get a better position, right? It was just like, I can just show up and I'll get paid.
I think some people still need to be somehow micromanaged, but it sucks that there's a word for that now. But some people do take advantage of their positions and they need to be micromanaged.
Oh, yeah.
I can see myself micromanaging somebody, but I know that I get in trouble for it. If they're just like slacking off some people don't always have the best way of doing things, and you might know, but they see it as micromanaging them.
But you remember Theory X and Theory Y that we talked about last semester? Have you learned this already? Theory X and Theory Y?
Yeah, if you covered it in the first lecture,
Yeah.
But I've had it in other courses.
So Theory X and Theory Y, right? Certain courses just dictate a Theory X kind of approach. I mean, there's no artistic way to scan a credit card, for example. I mean, you either do it or you don't, right? And so Theory X is very appropriate. And Taylor is describing industrial management. Whereas Theory Y is, you know, the artistic, you know, yeah, you can give people more freedom, right? Follett probably would fall more into a Theory Y, but I don't think she's exactly Theory X or Theory Y. She's kind of her own thing. Okay, so far so good? So this is her kind of swipe at Taylor. I'm sure Taylor never even heard of her by the time he died, so. Let's see. So here's an interesting thing. Executive leadership can, in part, be learned, knowledge versus opinion. So it's
119 or 118, depending on how you count the pages. The image of a masterful man carrying all before him by the sheer force of his personality has largely disappeared. We could use a little bit of that today.
Okay.
One good result of this is that we now consider that executive leadership can, in part, I say only in part, be learned. Oliver Sheldon, too, calls leadership an intangible capacity. I do not wholly agree. Someone else says it's beyond human calculation. There are many things, we hope, which have not yet been calculated, which are not beyond calculation. Isn't that true? Okay. And I think one of the hopes for business management lies in the fact that executive leadership is capable of analysis and that men can be trained to occupy such positions. I do not, of course, mean every man, right? I do not mean every man can become a doctor or an architect. I mean that for business management, exactly as for other professions, training is gaining in importance over mere personality. I know a man who told me 10 or 15 years ago that he relied on his personality in business dealings. He has not made a success of his business. It was once thought that the executive's work rested largely on hunch and on his subordinates on obeying no science in either case. The administrative head who relies on the magic shortcut of hunch and secondly on his adroitness or masterfulness in getting others to accept his hunch is, I believe, about to be superseded by a different type. So what's going on here?
Knowledge.
What's that?
Need knowledge.
New knowledge?
Need knowledge.
Yeah.
You can't just go on your own or what if the other guy on his personality.
Yeah.
Or his hunch.
Yeah, there's
yeah,
exactly. His personality.
Yeah, there's gotta be some
knowledge.
Trailing. Am I getting ahead of myself? I think I am.
Knowledge at the bottom.
No, I think I am getting ahead of myself. But you know what? Let me get ahead of myself because I think this is important. And we'll kind of skip it when we get to it later. So Mary Parker Follett is saying that management can actually be taught and it can be a profession. Remember Plato talking about this too, right?
It has to be something within you.
So part of it may be within you, right? And some things might also be taught, right? So she has kind of a slightly different aspect, right? It's not so much that management is virtue, but management might actually be a form of knowledge, she thinks, right? And because it's knowledge, I know I'm getting ahead of myself, but I want to talk about this now. Remember Mary Parker Follett's discussion about management as a profession later on in the text. Do you guys remember her discussion? What is she saying? What is a profession, anyhow? What does that mean?
Something that you're trained in?
Yeah, there's some sort of a training, there's some sort of a curriculum.
Is it like a skill?
Yeah, there's a skill, you are a bona fide, whatever you are. Alright, you are, you know, when you are a dentist, you have gone to dental school. You know, there's not like exploratory dentistry. You know, like pull that tooth out, see what happens, and then put it back in, right? No. I mean, the dentist should know what they're doing when they start working, right? They should have some sort of a training. And yet management, in many ways, that doesn't seem to be the case, right? It seems like people say, I'm the boss, I'm the manager, I'm the leader, right? There's no real formal training to go with it. Now, when you think about this, you want to become a doctor or a dentist or a lawyer, you have to pass a professional board or a certification, right? You pass your bar exam, your medical boards, if you want to be a CPA, you take the CPA exam, you know, whatever it is, right? But there's like hoops you have to jump through, right? Management does not have that. When you take an MBA, you know, I mean, there's no like thesis at the end or any sort of certification that's universally recognized.
That's interesting. I was thinking about that because, you know, in a lot of other master programs, you have to write a thesis or test out, right? And then,
oh, yeah.
But then, you know, as an MBA, you don't have to do that.
No, most MBAs you do not. Some you do. I think here you have to either write a thesis or do a project, and most people do the project. Right, and this is unusual, actually, that there's a capstone.
So I work in project management for construction, and for property management, and they have certifications now that can be used to value your knowledge, value your worth.
Project management stuff, but that's just getting started, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's not fully acknowledged. I mean, I don't know. I mean, it may be helpful. It may not be, but it's not something offered like in a university setting, for example.
No. What happens is you have to have a bachelor's degree in most cases to get the certification.
Yeah.
There are some universities, I think, offering them like in certificates, because
yeah,
I think my
some.
Cousin was doing something like that at a UC San Diego somewhere down there, and he was project manager, manager something. It was like a weekend course or something. I was
no, we're talking about two different
things. Oh, is that what
you're talking about? PMP, right?
You're talking about certified work.
Since
I thought you were, there's the other option of not certified.
So different.
That's
no,
not
it's,
certification.
It's an organization that's endorsing you.
I want you to bring this
and so they have all these requirements, and one of them is that you have a bachelor's degree. They don't really care in what field,
something.
But that it shows that you've completed.
Yeah, mine, I think, that the one he was doing, he didn't even need an associate, so it was just more like...
Esperella's got a good point, though, with this. I want you to repeat that one more time, because I think it's a valid point.
I mean, it's pretty hard to be able to write something or to make a program just for this. Just given that, like, in the dentist, there's, like, certain procedures that they do follow. But this is different because every corporation has different cultures and different, like, organizations are built differently as from
well,
one
yeah,
another.
You could manage anything.
Of course,
and
could you not get training in integration? Because every situation is different, right? Every situation has its own truth or law. So could you not get training in how to integrate? And that could be your management training. Certain kinds of doctrine. I mean, obviously it's never happened, so who am I to say?
Right.
Right?
The basics that would apply to anything.
Yeah. I mean, just like, you know, you get your MD and you pass a medical board, and heart surgery is very different than, I don't know, bone surgery. And you have to pass
plastic
the
surgery.
They have one procedure compared to like a heart surgery. There's only like one procedure. You can't perform it in 20 different ways.
Yeah.
Like, and but in different, in business, like you can make a decision in 20 different ways. You don't have to like follow one procedure. And also every company has its own organization, like its own culture that they follow different steps. And sometimes you have to follow those different steps, or you could just go along with it, or you could just create your own, and that's totally welcome in business management, compared to any other field, compared to science, or compared to medical.
Ah, but could not certain procedures be very similar, identical, and then you add your own flair?
You
I mean,
can.
Do not medical researchers add their own flair?
They
do
try,
not lawyers add their own flair?
They try, but they can't really get creative as much as we can in business.
But
so.
You can only be so creative in other fields, too.
Right.
But you're saying like they should have integration as a basis into.
For example, it may not be techniques; it may be a thought process.
So like a theory,
like. For example.
So like everything should start, but it's weird because that's not the way management works. Not in today. Like if I have a problem where I'm working, I'm not gonna grab my crew and be like, okay, everybody, let's huddle together and let's like try to build something where everybody's gonna end up happy. Usually, the person that has the position decides what the group should do, because in all ends the responsibility does fall into that person.
But
it doesn't have to be
that way. With the business owner, right?
Yeah.
If you're the business owner, then you can make those decisions, but if you're the manager working for a business owner, sometimes you don't have any choice because he's holding you accountable.
Right. Yeah.
And this is the whole, I mean, you know, everything that you're talking about was absolutely the same in Mary Parker Falls time. And the whole point of what she's saying is, hey, it doesn't have to be this way, right? And there are organizations that are very much Philetian in orientation. I mean, there's a book that I highly recommend to you guys if you like management books. It's called Maverick, with an exclamation mark. It's called The Story of Simcoe. It's by a guy named Ricardo Simler. And everything he does is almost Philetian. Simcoe, it's a Brazilian company. They manage pumps and heavy industrials. And when you read it, it screams Mary Parker followed. There's no real hierarchies in his organization. Everybody kind of comes to work. As long as they get everything done, it's okay. There's no offices. There's no executive parking spots. If you need an office, you sign one out. It's a very interesting book. I highly recommend it. It's about maybe 350 pages. So you're right, Esmeralda. This is the way it's run today. But the whole point of Mary Park Hall is it doesn't have to be that way. Must it be that way or not? And you don't have to agree with her 100%, but the whole idea is, can you question a little bit?
It depends, I believe, in the job. Like, just in the organization, because I don't think there's some organization that have the flexibility that every time we come to an end where we can't all agree, do we have the time that everybody has to come up with the same decision where we're all going to be happy? And that's kind of hard. That's where I would hit a wall with her theory or whatever she's talking about.
And I think to people like in management, I think we become used to being managed if you're not in the management position. Mm-hmm. So you always look for direction, right? So one of the things that I'm learning as I'm trying to move up in my career is like I've met people that have never done the jobs that they're managing, but they manage all throughout their career. So like at one point they learned the job that they were doing, and then they moved into management, and then just kept shifting into management positions. But it's like, you know, you get a different perspective from somebody that has done the job and then gone into management to manage that specific job, but you also get a different perspective from somebody else that's just been in management their whole career. So you're like, I think when people try to collaborate, it's also like having somebody control it, right? Control the collaboration, control like what's really going on, because there's 10 different people and they all have different 10 different ideas how you really get to
Maybe if we had manager training, like Paula was saying, we would know. Mm-hmm. Possibly. How do arbitrators work? I mean, are they not trained in integration?
Yeah.
And is that not their occupation, trying to find solutions that both parties agree to?
Yes,
and did they not go through common training? And yes, they do apply it to law, but can we not apply that to management as well? And you're right, it will never be 100% perfect. And remember, Paula says that. Sometimes it won't be 100% perfect. And some people just don't want to integrate.
That's right.
That happens too, right? She acknowledges that. But we should try as many times as we can. Of course, as I mentioned, there's no artistic way to swipe a credit card. You just have to tell people this is how you do it, right? But other things, yeah, why not? Why not? Does this kind of make sense, what she's getting at? Does it make a little more sense? Yeah, sometimes it doesn't always work, right? That's her whole point. But we should try as much as we can. And we can be trained in some of it. But not all of it, I agree. When you open up someone's heart surgery and you open up someone's like stomach operation and you know there's like this telepathic alien from Mars in it, and it's like nobody saw that movie? No, that was that movie with Arnold Schwarzenegger. Total Recall.
Oh, yeah.
That's really cool.
Yeah, but you said open up your stomach. You opened up the shirt.
No, was it? I thought it was his stomach. Anyway.
He opens up his shirt and the thing comes out of the stomach.
Oh,
it sounded like you said they cut it up the stomach.
How I remembered it, but maybe that wasn't it. Okay.
Yeah. I remember that.
The whole thing, like, in theory,
yeah.
It sounds really great just because it would make that everybody would work more efficiently because everybody would be happy with the outcomes of, like, everything you do at work. Because then, when people don't get their way, that's how people, saboteurs come about. Because now they're not happy at the job, and now, okay, well, they didn't get my way, they got his way, or whatever, so now I'm going to be out to get them.
Yeah.
Or I call it sick at the last moment.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes not everybody's going to be happy with me.
I'm just
You should see how Scandinavians manage. They almost everything they do is based on consensus. Man, it's a very consensus-oriented society, and I think her ideas work very well in Scandinavian culture. Now, I had a friend from Germany who worked in Scandinavia, and she hated it. She said she was sick and tired of being in meetings where everybody had to say their piece, and they never got anything done. That was her perspective. But she was a very domination-slash-coercion type of person, so maybe that didn't work for her. She wanted to just be in charge. And so she left. Sweet, go back to Germany. But you see, there are certain contexts where this works really well. Now, remember we talked about Jeff Check on socialization? I think people can also be socialized to accept this kind of behavior, right? And so that might take time, that may take generations. Paula didn't do it in her day, but in some parts of Europe, again, Northern Europe and SEMCO, I mean, it can happen. It's kind of a process, it may take years, right? Okay, so we'll skip over that part when I get to it later in the slides. What do you think about this, whole discussion on 119. Oh, by the way, before I move on, does this make sense, what she's getting at? Have I made this clear so far? Okay. So, depending on 119, 120, depending on your pages, right? It talks about rights. A significant indication of the different type of management required today is the fact that managers are somewhat less inclined to justify their behavior by a claim of abstract rights. I love this. An employer used to say, I have a right to treat my men so-and-so, or my behavior is, in this matter, is perfectly reasonable. Today, there are many more who are inclined to say, if I treat my men so-and-so, how will they behave? Why will they behave in that way? It takes far more science to understand human beings and their rights than to proclaim loudly our own rights and reasonableness. So, what do you guys think about that one?
It's the worst excuse for giving an order.
Oh, yeah. Remember we talked about the rights ethic last semester and then also earlier? You know, I have a right to free speech. I have a right to
privacy.
Whatever. Yeah, and so is it fair for me to say I have the right to free speech and for me to, like, insult people? I mean, technically, I guess I have the right to do it, but should I? Should I do that? Right? And that's exactly what she's getting at here. Right? I mean, I guess you could say I have a right to manage you because I'm paying your paycheck. But you're going to have that coercion. You're going to have that desire suppression, all that stuff. And is that a good idea? Again, eventually they'll come to resent you.
Well,
versus,
you're not giving the person any reason. Does that mean you don't have a good reason? And that's why you're saying, well, I have a right to do that.
Yeah.
I actually was working with someone who didn't have any kind of business experience. And we're having this conversation on the phone, and he wants to take one of the employees and have her do additional work. And it was a really bad idea. And I tried to explain every reason about why it was a bad idea. And he said, I don't care. I'm the boss. That's what I want to do.
Yeah.
And he had no argument. He just felt like, well, it shouldn't matter. I should just get to do whatever I want.
And how did that work out for him?
I said, I don't want to hang up on you, so I'm going to tell you that I'm going to end the call. And then his partner called me and said, what happened? And I told him, he said, I'll talk to you.
You see, that was kind of like the integration that we talked about that I had last time, right? It was, you know, one individual, and then, you know, maybe somebody else can explain it better or differently or something like that, right?
Yeah, or listen, maybe.
That too. Right.
What
yeah.
about like acquisitions? Mm-hmm. Like when you acquire a company and you go through that, and then sometimes some companies keep maybe the other company's policies, or they keep, you know, and then there's all the adjustment phase, right? Like, so all that integration. And they do hire people to help through that integration process. That's kind of crazy.
But of course, you know, that's tough, right? I mean, they'll get let go, whatever.
Yeah.
I think it's the same thing that was happening with my boss, keeping from trying to give me the raise. Every time he kept trying to back over, well, I keep trying to give you more work, but you're not really inclined to it. I'm like, well, I'm already working overtime. I only have so many hours in a day.
Oh, yeah.
His excuse was like that I was being like, just saying no every time.
They just lose all credibility.
Yeah. Because again, they're not asking that question. How do you really feel? And by the way, sometimes you have a legitimate reason. Maybe you are working overtime, you're doing X, Y, and Z, and you know, all this thing. If they just listen and they got to the truth of the situation, then they know.
Yeah, it's always a questioning, well, how long is it taking you to do this? How long is it taking you to do that? It shouldn't take you this long to do this. I mean, it's like, he didn't know what I was doing, but yet that was his excuse to let me go. Oh, and that I would be happier as a receptionist at a different office that would pay me more. I was like, okay.
Yeah. I know. It's frustrating.
That's okay, his office is
so I think
down.
We got the anti-rights.
Yeah, I think we got that one. Yes, I mean, I hear it, I just feel like, so, I feel like so bad when I hear these kinds of stories, but yet I know they're true.
His ship is sinking. His ship is sinking.
Yeah.
People are quitting.
What'd you think about this economic history that she gives on kind of, I don't know, 120, 121, 122, depending on how you count the pages.
Where are you? Oh.
great epics of history described by John Commons. Okay, so first was the era of scarcity. Now that ended in the 15th century, supposedly. Then there's the era of abundance, you know, where we had laissez-faire. And then there was the era of stabilization, okay, and where laissez-faire should be abandoned in favor of deliberate conscious control of economic forces for the sake of general social good. And now you kind of see why sometimes Mary Parker Follett gets confused with being a communist.
Yeah.
I mean, we know communism because we've read Marx, so we know it's very different. But we can see that there's some similarities that can be confusing. I think today there's less inclination to take refuge in such excuses. There's a tendency to seek the difficulty in running of the business. Okay? Whatever thinking takes the place of fighting, we have a striking inclination to believe that management is coming to rest on scientific foundations. And she kind of goes on. So, in some ways, I mean, this is a very European perspective, right? The idea that maybe people of technical expertise can be the ones to help us figure out what's best for us, right? And you remember what that video with Nigel Farage, you know, berating that Herman Van Rompuy was saying, right? I mean, this Herman Van Rompuy is an unelected official. He's some sort of a technocrat who knows a lot of stuff, and he's the ones making decisions for people in countries that aren't even his own. What a wild idea, right? But yet we kind of see it fall to an extent, don't we? Hey, Rashid.
What's up?
Yeah, I can see it. Does this make sense, what she's getting at? So this is actually kind of an anti-democracy kind of thing, right? We don't elect politicians based on popular vote. You know, you start getting to this idea that someone with exceptional technical ability should be the one making decisions for general societal good. That'll keep you up at night, right? So, I love this. Why don't you talk about kind of this discussion of what management is?
What
page are you? It's always a trick question. It's either 122 or 123.
The bottom number.
Oh, yes.
To the top
so
of the
on your argument, we would say 123.
Okay.
On mine, it would be 122. So, she talks about on the technical side, there's some sort of a knowledge of production, distribution, right? That's the scientific side. And then on the personal side, how to deal fairly with one's fellows. Okay, the first has been, you know, something that can be taught, and the latter is thought to be some sort of a gift. Okay. She kind of goes on. The reason we are studying human relations and industries, we believe there can be a science of cooperation. This is the whole thing that we're getting into about, you know, management as a profession. But this, I mean, that cooperation is not, and I insist on, merely a matter of good intentions, of kindly feeling. It must be based on these, but you cannot have successful cooperation until you've worked out the methods of cooperation by experiment after experiment, by a comparing of experiments, by a pooling of results. What's she saying here? Almost appears to be advocating like case studies or something to try to figure out management. That way I should check the time. Okay.
Is that what she said?
That's kind of the way that I interpret it. What do you think?
Now that you're mentioning it, yeah, like, because we do look at other cases, like, when a business does fail, I'm always taken to business, but I know she's talking about it in theory, but when businesses do fail, we do examine it to be able to, like, think how what management does should require or shouldn't require to, like, be able to grow or change a business for the better.
Experiment the methods that you're about to use. They don't work, you do another one. You change them. It's like you keep changing till it works for the business.
And so that could be another side. There's two sides of it, right? When you talk about the experimentation, and she's saying there's two components to management, right? There's the scientific side, the mechanical side, and that is absolutely experimentation based, right? I mean, did you turn the crank or did you not, for example, right? Did you hammer it, did you not? But then this other side with the human relations side. May not be experimentation friendly, right? But it may be, again, you look at a case or maybe you look at aggregate data or some way like that. And this is kind of how management education might come about in some way. You have to remember, when she's writing, there was no management education whatsoever. There was no MBA, nothing. All your managers were engineers at that time. But yeah, does that make sense? Yeah, so maybe by studying other people. And it's not a coincidence that Mary Parker Follett gives all these little stories. These are, okay, before we had case studies. But these are ways of aggregating experience.
Right.
She gives some sort of a special example, and then you read all these stories at the end, and you know something, right?
Is she saying that the personnel part can't be taught, or
that it's like inherited, or
it's not the whole thing.
Yeah, it's so so there's a couple things you're saying here. First of all, there's two sides to management, mechanical and human.
Mm.
Right? The mechanical obviously can be taught engineers, all the
yeah.
right? The human side, however, right? She's saying, well, how can it be taught exactly? Well, maybe through cases and aggregation of experiences. Maybe.
So interesting thing about that is before I left my job last year, they were actually doing, like, our department had to, each, like, team member had to take a personality test.
Mm-hmm.
And we had to answer these, like, scenario questions that determine, like, how we worked and how we took, like, direction from other people.
Mm-hmm.
And, so I feel like now it's still being developed, but it probably could be taught in the future.
Yeah, maybe.
What about like startups, right? I mean, startups, a lot of the way that they're approaching, there's also still like the traditional part, I guess, in comparing like the accounting and all that stuff, but then there's all the other new different avenues of establishing like business models, right? Like, well, you do things so differently than what was all like ABC corporations do in corporate America. But I mean, that works for them.
Wouldn't the apps incorporate both?
What's that?
Wouldn't the apps just any app incorporate both scenarios that you just said, the mechanical and the...
Let's answer that. Let's answer this in the next paragraph, because she does say this.
Oh.
So she answers in the next paragraph. Okay? In all of our study of personnel work, we should remember clearly that we can never wholly separate the human and the mechanical problem, just like you said, Cindy. Right?
Well, she says that you can never separate them.
That's right.
Oh, okay. So I said put together. Okay.
Yeah, which is exactly, you hit on the head. And that's not a coincidence she made that statement, by the way. She's specifically taking a swipe at Taylor. Because Taylor says that a man and a machine, you know, the management is, you know, it can, certain issues are very mechanical, and many of the issues are, but there's some that are more human on the other side, right?
It's under mechanical, and you said that you wanted the balance to be successful in some way. And it's like, but then wouldn't you need somebody supervising that they actually are following? And
yeah, so he managed them just like a machine. Right, so at the end of the day, you know, great, your task has been designed, you're all ready to go. And did you put that coal in the bucket or not? And then the supervisor checks, yeah, good job. You know, Schmidt is one of the famous guys in the book. Good job, Schmidt. You haul 120 pounds of pig iron today. And then you get a little slip, and then you either get paid your bonus or you don't. But once they teach you to design the task, they don't actually follow up the whole time. There's some follow-up, but mostly they're checking your output. And because if you design, if you get, you know, not 120 pounds, but, or 120 tons, but 160 tons, then they actually go back and investigate why, and so that your method can be spread. So
right, like that guy's faster, what's he doing? Let's
why
copy
is he
that.
So good?
Yeah,
exactly.
Could an example of mechanic and people be, like, I saw some sort of special,
mm-hmm.
I think it's coin bits? Is that what those things are called?
Bitcoins.
Yeah.
How it's all, like, it's a huge warehouse full of all these machines, but there's still somebody in there that has to be, like, watching over them, making sure they're working properly. If they break, they go and replace it. So it's like, it's machine and person still having...
There's still some piece there, yeah. Things have to be, you cannot assume it's a machine-only problem, you cannot assume it's only a human relations problem. What you're saying is you have to understand that, in contrast to Taylor, where you can say a man and a machine are the same and they're managed. No, you have to accept there's a human side to everything. And then Bitcoin's an interesting idea, right?
Mm-hmm.
I had this conversation today with one of my colleagues, and he was talking about a university that I'm not going to name. And he was saying, why do we have so many administrators? Why in the world can we not just have a pay system? A pay system that just works and we don't have to pay a person to monitor our pay. And I said, but wait a second, what if your paycheck doesn't come? You want to have somebody that you can scream at. Because you can't scream at a computer.
Isn't that like human resources though? Like HR, you'd say?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
HR, finance.
But people still want to speak to a physical body at some point.
That's right. And I gave the example. So the Army has this organization called I think all the military, it serves the whole military, it's called Defense.
Department
Finance. Something. You're close, yeah.
It's close.
Yeah. But, you know, they're like in Indianapolis somewhere, and there's thousands of employees, and yeah, there's a whole really robust system in the Army, in my opinion.